And I want to read from this passage, 2 Kings, the widow's olive oil. The widow's olive oil. The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elijah, "Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves." Elijah replied to her, "How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house?" "Your servant has nothing there at all," she said, "except a small jar of olive oil." Elijah said, "Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side." She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. When all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another one." But he replied, "There is not a jar left." Then the oil stopped flowing. She went and told the man of God, and he said, "Go, sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your son can live on what is left." Brothers and sisters, this is the word of God. What a year so far, and it's not even the end. We don't even know what's the story of the last 2 months going to be of 2020. What we know is that this is going to be a very interesting time for all of us. And just think about what happened to you, what happened to us, what happened to your family and friends, what happened with you at your work situation this last 7 months. I think if we look back, we will say, "Oh, this is just a dream. Whenever we're going to wake up, this is going to be over." But guess what? This is reality that we live in. Just think of the amount of things that changed in your life. Let us start with school, with our children. Suddenly, they closed the schools. Suddenly, there was a lockdown. And in a blink of an eye, the next morning, you are the teacher. How great was that? Suddenly, in a blink of an eye, you have to understand the apps that the school sent you to use for the education of your children. Suddenly, the basements, which was more or less the storage area, became the school. Suddenly, mothers become the teachers and fathers the principals. Kids did not like that most of the time. I'm sure about that. My kids, they were just happy when the school bus stopped in front of the parsonage. Janette and I, we did the victory dance in the sunroom. It was great. Things changed. Think about your work situation. Suddenly, you're not in your office. The things that you are used to, it's not there anymore. Suddenly, you have to work from your home. And let us be honest, that first week, that was good. You can sleep a little bit later. There's not a boss watching over your shoulder, what you're doing. I think it was good for the first week. And then suddenly we say, we need our colleagues. We need to sit around a table. Those meetings that I hate in the past, suddenly I miss them because I miss the people. Think about what happened with your summer vacation. I always say this, and this is, you mustn't see it in that serious light. I think coronavirus was very good for Zion Reformed Church. You know what? Our attendance was up with more than 14%. Guess what? It was not only new ones coming, but the older ones, the members that did not go on a summer vacation because they couldn't get out of Iowa. They cannot jump on a plane. So guess what? You can only come to church on a Sunday. That was great. And now, everything even at the church changed. Some days, the days like today, we were outside. The wind was blowing all my notes away. Today we are inside. Just think about those days. And I think the worst of it all, think about what happened with families that lost someone during this time. I had a good friend in South Africa, 40 years old, with three boys, a daughter and his wife, all of them still in school. He got the virus. They took him to the hospital. They couldn't even talk to their dad or a husband. He couldn't even talk to his wife and his children in the time most needed. Some people say the worst form, the nightmare of any death, is to die alone, without your family, without a loved one next to you. That happened in 2020. My friend passed away without his wife next to him, without his children, and they lost a husband and a dad without even being able to say goodbye. That's the tough things of 2020. But brothers and sisters, what happened in the world of 2 Kings chapter 4? I think similar conditions. There was a woman with her sons. It doesn't say how many sons, but it's in the plural form. There's more than one son. What happened? In a very tough time, in this whole story of Israel, she lost her husband. A husband that followed Elijah, listened to the word of God, feared God, and suddenly this woman lost her husband. These sons lost their dad. And let us be honest with each other. It's not comparable, the circumstances of those days versus the circumstances of what we have today. A woman those days, she have to raise the kids. She's not there outside. She is not a public figure. She doesn't live in the corporate world. She doesn't stand there in the middle of the town and share her thoughts. No. You have to be home. The husbands, the sons, they took care of the needs of a family. And now guess what? The nightmare of all nightmares that can happen to a woman in those days, she lost her husband. Sons lost their father. And guess what? The father did not have a lot of money. Let us be honest, he had no money. There was creditors, debt collectors standing outside that property of the widow and her sons. Say, listen, we want your property. We want your sons. Now think about it. You just lost your husband. The next moment, the creditors are standing in front of your door and say, we want our money. You better pay up. And she knows she's going to lose that because that was the law of those days. The creditors can come afterwards and get that property. But this is not the end of this nightmare. You know what was the law? A creditor can take your children as slaves to pay the debts. Listen to this. Look at your child if he's sitting next to you. They can take your child and say, you owe me this is my new slave. Your daughter, your sons, go read the prophets of Amos, Nehemiah. That's where you will find these things. So, what was the situation that time? A nightmare, a terrible year for that family. Why? They lost a husband. They lost a father. More than that, they're going to lose their property. They don't have any place to go. And the widow is going to lose her children because they're going to take them as slaves. Isn't that terrible? It's terrible. I think that's the nightmare of all nightmares that's going to happen. But then, the whole story changed. The story changed because the prophet Elijah came into the story and he looked at this widow and said, listen, there's a plan. There's an outcome. There's a better future. There's prosperity for you. And just think of what is that woman thinking at that moment. Oh, what can possibly change my life? I lost my husband. They're going to take my children. They're going to take my home. I have nothing. And without even having this conversation, Elijah said, what do you have? Just a small jar with oil in it. Olive oil. Pure olive oil. Something special to have. And Elijah said, oh, I have good news. You go now to your neighbors and collect jars as much as you can. So first of all, you have nothing and now you have to go beg your neighbors to get a jar, an empty jar, and think what they're thinking. Oh, I wonder what this crazy woman and her sons is going to do now with empty jars. But God had a plan. Through Elijah, what did he do? He said, now you fill this empty jars with this olive oil, which is very special. And she did that. And you can just think about the faces of those sons and that widow. Suddenly, of this little olive oil, it's jars and jars and jars. And what does the scripture tell us? There was a time that she said, okay, my son, give me another one. He said, Mom, this is all full. What happened? This is a miracle. And then she ran to Elijah and said, Elijah, there's just so much olive oil. What are we going to do with this? Because you did not tell me what to do with this olive oil. He said, now you're going to go and sell it. The Lord provided. Here is the olive oil. Go sell it. And the rest, after the collectors took their part of it, there will be enough to live on it. Isn't that great news? A 2020 year changed into a very prospective year. Suddenly there's hope. Suddenly there's life. Suddenly they have the opportunity to live without worries again. I'm not going to tell you the whole story of the first Kings about Elijah, the other prophet, and the other widow from Zarephath. It was drought. There was nothing. But this prophet, Elijah, what did happen? God said, don't worry. You will have enough food. You will have enough water to drink. But there was a time that the water even dried up. And he said, Elijah, don't worry. Go to this widow at Zarephath. Go there and she will look after you. And then the strange man walked up to the widow and said, listen, you have to feed me. She was poor. She lost her husband. She doesn't have anything to provide except a little bit of flour and guess what? Oil. She says, but you know what I'm busy doing, Elijah? Strange man, man that I don't know, man without an identity. I don't know you, but I have to feed you in this very hard circumstances. I want to tell you what I'm busy doing. This firewood that I collect, this is the last fire that we're going to make. Because I have a little bit of flour and a little bit of oil and we're going to prepare our last meal with this. And listen to this. Go read this. 1 Kings chapter 17 tonight. Elijah said, just go and do that. She did that. But you know what? The flour never stopped. The jars was just filling up. The oil was just getting more and more. And the Lord said, I will provide until the first rains again. A place that was stuffed became a place of hope. What do we get out of the Word of God today? Let us be honest. This was a tough year. This was an unfamiliar year for a lot of us. For some of us, it was good. Some circumstances in this whole period was good for us. Lessons that we learned. But let's be honest. Wouldn't it be nice if we wake up and we see this Happy New Year cards next to our beds that say 2021, and there's a cure for the virus, and everything is over, all the political sensitivity and issues is over, and we can just live. Wouldn't that be nice? I think this is what we pray for. This is what we pray for in our church. This is what you prayed for in your devotion time every day, I'm sure about it. Pray for peace, we pray for outcome, we pray for poverty, we pray that the Lord will give the leaders of this world enough wisdom and discernment. But for my soul, I just want to get rid of this. Maybe you lost a loved one in this year. It's terrible. Think about how many funerals were there this year where your family and friends couldn't stand next to you because they were not allowed. You buried your husband and your wife and your brother and your sister and friend without even being there. Bad times. What I don't say is to say, oh, 2020, COVID is nothing to compare about those times in the Old Testament. That's not what we say. We say terrible conditions versus terrible conditions. But what's the outcome? What changed the lives of those widows and their sons those days? Nothing else than God. God changed everything. God used prophets to work through. And what happened? God provided. God provided stability. There was life again. The renewal of the scar that I have, this life that I have, the opportunity suddenly. Where are you today? Maybe we will find ourselves where the widows was. And if we are there, what must we do? Lord, here I am. Change my life. Change my circumstances. Lord, my identity is in you. I believe in you. And I know what you promise. You promise that I will take care. You know what? There was even a worse time than those days in the Old Testament with widows without husbands and children who was going to become slaves. There is even a worse time in the history of life than COVID 2020. You know what was those days? Those days before the crucifixion of Jesus. Why? No future for sinners. No future for one of us. Terrible times. If you're going to die, you know what's going to happen with you. There's no eternal life. There's not something to look forward to. That was a time in the history of this world where it was dark. But guess what? God provided again. He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, and guess what? We have eternal life for those who believe in Him. Then, suddenly, we have our identity in Christ. We are His children. We have a Father that looked to us eternally. Where do we find our identity today? Nowhere else than in the Lord Jesus Christ. Our God, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit that will take care of us. And you know what? We don't believe in prosperity theology. What does that mean? Oh, if I believe, I will have a lot of money. I will have a great future. No, that's not why we believe. We believe because if we believe, we will be saved from sins and we will have eternal life in heaven with Christ. That's why we believe. But guess what? It's coming with that package. God said, don't worry, I will take care of you because I'm your Father. Guess what? We are His children and we are not slaves anymore. No one can take us and make us slaves. We are saved. We are free through Jesus Christ. And this is where we're going to say, praise be to God, because 2020 was tough, but guess what? We have hope. Where do we find that hope? In the identity of Christ.